Hey guys, for this base build, I wanted to try something completely different just to see if it was possible. It was my goal to take this cheapo jazz bass kit and turn it into a full-on Jaguar clone. Now, none of this Squire Vintage modified junk, although it's not actually junk, it's actually pretty good, but this bass has all the features of a full-on Jaguar Deluxe bass, complete with all the extra switches and plates, roller knobs, and even a few extra bells and whistles of my own. I'm Dan, this is Guns of Guitars, and I'm gonna tell you all about how I did it right now. Perhaps the best thing about this build is that it comes in at less than $280, because I've listened to your guys' feedback and I know that you guys want to see how to make high-end instruments on a really low budget. Now, I modeled my bass build off of the older Made in Japan Jag basses that came with jazz pickups, as opposed to the newer American-made PJ setup. I really liked those Japanese Jaguar basses, and you just can't get them anymore unless you're lucky enough to find one used, and even then they usually fetch over $1,000. So I set out to make one for just a tad less. Now, I started this build with just a basic cheapo $75 jazz bass kit that I got from Tom Top. Now, I put a link in the description for you, but just a quick reminder, if you live in the US, you need to select the US warehouse for shipping in order to get that price. Also, just a little tip for you guys, if you hang out on their website for long enough, usually a coupon code will appear that will save you an extra 5%. Now, this jazz bass kit was definitely not bad, especially for $75, but it was far from perfect and there were a few things that needed fixing. Firstly, a jazz bass does not look like a Jaguar bass, but it's actually closer than you'd think. Like my wife, it's got all the right curves in all the right places. All you gotta do is chop down the horns a little bit to get her looking perfect. My jazz bass, not my wife. I would never chop off her horns. Honk honk. So stupid, why do I make these jokes? Okay. At any rate, a jigsaw and a Dremel with a sanding drum made quick work out of reshaping the body. The neck on this thing wasn't perfect either. The frets did need to be leveled and crowned. Now, if you haven't seen it yet, I do have a video on how to make your own Pro Luthier tools. And in that video, I have a nice in-depth tutorial on how to level and crown your own frets. So if you haven't seen it, check it out. But the long and short of it is, it's pretty easy to do, it just takes some time. And lastly, because the neck came with a blank paddle style headstock, I got to shape it into my own custom design, which I later found out is almost exactly the same as a boutique bass brand called Sandberg. It's not exactly the same, so I guess it still could be my own design, but it's close enough that it could get confused for a Sandberg, and I really don't want it to. So, back to the drawing board. For pickups, I really wanted a double J humbucker like Fender used to use in their older P-Bass Deluxe. Now, I couldn't actually find an original Fender humbucker used at the time of this project, so I settled for this Artec double J humbucker that I got on eBay for $29. But this one is spec'd outright with the correct output rating and Alnico 5 magnets. And unlike the original Fender humbucker, it comes with 4-conductor wiring, so I could have a little bit of fun with wiring it. But to fit this humbucker in, I had to remove a little bit of material and route out the body. It was actually pretty easy. I just lined up the pickup with the old jazz pickup route and traced it, and then routed out the extra material. Now, as you guys know, usually I just use my Dremel to route out extra cavities in my guitars, but this year for Christmas, I got a $30 trim router from Harbor Freight. I know, Santa really splurged this year, but it actually works pretty awesome. When I was done, I went ahead and fixed the last issue that I had with the kit and drilled a hole for the bridge ground connect wire. Now, to match the hot output of this bridge humbucker, I picked up this DiMarzio hot jazz pickup used on Reverb for just $45. Now, it also came with 4-conductor wiring, so again, I got to have some fun. More on that later. Now, the thing that really sets apart the Japanese Jaguar Deluxe basses from the cheaper Squire versions are all the extra switches, knobs, and control plates. They just give you way more tonal options, and they give it a really cool classic look. Now, luckily, I was able to find all those parts on Amazon and Reverb, but it did add to the cost significantly since they are genuine Fender parts. So just a quick summary of what I did here. This upper control plate was $10. There's a bracket underneath that was $13 that holds these roller pots onto the control plate. And these roller knobs were actually $11 a piece for a total of $22. This lower control switch plate was $9, and 4 double pull double throw slide switches at $5 a piece. So if you wanted to skip out on those control plates, roller knobs, and switches, you'd actually save about $75. But for this build, I actually thought that it was worth it. Lastly, to complete this build, I needed a preamp, so I bought this Tone Monster preamp on eBay for just $49. I chose this preamp because, in addition to being able to boost and cut treble, there's actually a selectable mid frequency range for boosting or cutting the mids. And that there was a really cool feature that I wanted to add to my Jaguar bass to make it stand out a little more from the rest. I made this pickguard out of some scrap 1/8 inch birch plywood that was left over from my P-Base pickguard that I made. You can find a decent sized sheet of 1/8 inch birch plywood at a craft shop for about $4. To make the pickguard, I just made a template out of construction paper, traced it onto the wood, and cut it out with my jigsaw. Then finished up the small details again with my Dremel. Man, I love my Dremel. Well, actually, this one's not even a Dremel, it's the Black & Decker version, but whatever, same thing. Once my pickguard was made, I traced where the additional control cavities would be and routed it out, as well as a cavity for the battery box, which I got on Amazon for $3 with free Prime shipping. Okay, now on to the really fun part. For the finish, I did this really cool iridescent emerald green to blue to black burst. And I'll show you how I did that right now. And to do this, I used plain, undiluted liquid RIT dye. And here's how. First, I did one coat of emerald green RIT dye. Then, I lightly dabbed some royal blue RIT dye around the perimeter and blended it in with the emerald green. Next, I did the same thing with black RIT dye, but an even smaller amount just around the edges. Now, you could stop here if you like it, but it does look a little bit blotchy. So here's the trick they don't teach you in school, kids. Lightly sand with 220 grit sandpaper, then go over the whole thing one last time with the original color, in this case, emerald green. Now that's a killer iridescent burst. Of course, for me, that's a little too pretty, so I took some 320 grit sandpaper to it to make it look a little more broken in and to exaggerate the more contoured areas. For the pickguard, I just used black RIT dye first, then went over the top with the emerald green so that the wood grain matched the color of the base. Lastly, I slapped on 3 coats of my favorite Formby's tongue oil finish, and I was ready to wire it up. And let me tell you that wiring this monster was a real pain with the 3 different control cavities. Now, it probably didn't help that I did some really complex wiring hacks, which I'll tell you about in just a minute, but according to my calculations, I probably have roughly 20 feet of copper cable in this thing. And I don't want to brag, but I did get all the wiring right on like my 5th or 6th try. Wiring wise, this upper horn control plate is identical to a typical Jaguar bass. You have your active bass and treble controls and an active passive bypass switch. Now the lower control plate would typically be a neck on off, bridge on off, and then both pickups together in series or parallel. Boring! I wanted to do something more fun, so here's what I did. This switch right here is actually a 3-position switch. When it's in the middle, this rear pickup is in humbucker series mode. Push it up, you get the north coil only. Push it down, you get the south coil only. So you can choose if you want that big humbucker sound, or in the north position if you want your typical jazz bass sound, or in the south position if you want a brighter, thinner jazz bass sound. This middle switch right here controls the series or parallel wiring for the neck pickup. And lastly, this switch right here engages my top secret crossover tone circuit that I designed to take the low frequencies from the neck pickup, combine them from the mids and highs of the bridge pickup to get a more even frequency response without any phase cancellation. And moving on to our last control plate, this 12 gauge Winchester controls the blend between pickups. This 12 gauge Winchester controls the master volume. This 12 gauge Federal on the bottom controls the mid booster cut. And this 20 gauge Winchester on the top controls the frequency that you're boosting or cutting, anywhere between 800 Hz and 2 kHz. Okay, now finally, it's time to hear this thing. Now, for the sake of time, I'm not gonna bother comparing it to the original jazz bass kit before like I normally would, because it didn't sound all that interesting. If you wanna hear how the kit sounded before, check out my original review video on that. But here we have like a bazillion different combinations, and I'm not even gonna be able to get to demo them all anyway. So I'm just gonna focus on a few key tones that I know you guys wanna hear. As always, I'm gonna be recording directly into Logic Pro with no EQ or amp simulation so you guys can hear the raw input signal. And be sure that you're wearing some high quality headphones so that you can actually hear the subtle differences in tone here. Thank you. Love how these pickups sound just completely passive. They're nice and edgy and aggressive, and I'm actually really shocked at how good this Artek humbucker sounds, even when it's split. It's nice and bright with those Alnico 5 magnets, and it actually sounds pretty close to what I remember those original P-Bass Deluxe humbuckers sounding like. So for 29 bucks, I'm really happy with it. Now I know what you guys are thinking right now.
Dan, why didn't you demo the preamp or the crossover circuits?
Okay, calm down, I'll do it for you right now. But remember, there's like a bazillion different tone possibilities that you can get out of this thing. So real quick, I'm just gonna demo both the pickups passive versus both the pickups with the crossover and the preamp so you can get an idea of how drastic of a change you can get from it. And again, make sure you're wearing some really high quality headphones so you can hear the extended low end range that the crossover brings in. Okay, there you have it, an extremely versatile and aggressive sounding Jaguar Deluxe clone for less than 280 bucks. Now I already have a couple people interested in buying this bass, but if they don't follow through, after I'm done enjoying it for myself for a few weeks, I'll be listing it for sale on my website where I sell all my custom builds, gunsandguitars.net. Subscribe if you want to see more high-end builds on a low-end budget, and if you like what I'm doing here, please consider supporting me on Patreon for just $1 a month. It would seriously mean the world to me. I love you guys. I'm Dan, this is Guns and Guitars. Thanks for watching.